We are AMC.
Lawmakers defend state auditors who got a tongue lashing from President Duterte for exposing deficiencies in government's use of pandemic response funds. Meanwhile, a nurses group disappointed with the chief executive's refusal to punish Health Secretary Francisco Duque III for his failures. United Nations calls on the international community to ensure terrorism won't rise again in Afghanistan. We'll talk to security analyst Professor Romel Banlawi about the significance of the Taliban's return to power. And the death toll in Haiti's powerful quake now at 1,400, with thousands more injured. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us, and for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, nice to have you with us today. We begin with this story. Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte telling his cabinet members to ignore reports made by the Commission on Audit. He went on a tirade against the agency after it flagged the pandemic response budgets of the Departments of Health, Education, and ICT.
Wala namang mangyari dyan. Yan ang ayaw ko, yung flagging eh. Huwag naman sige kayo flag ng flag. Tapos wala namang napreso, wala naman lahat. And yet you know that when you flag, there is already a taint of corruption by perception. Alam ninyo, emergency to. It is a matter of life or death. So you have to understand and give it a little elbow room to move. Make emergency purchase, mag-utang. Ang utos ko ganon.
President Duterte also defended the health department, where the COA found supposed deficiencies in its use of over 67 billion pesos in COVID-19 funds. Duterte said it is impossible for the agency to steal that money.
Pag magkano ang COA, magsabi lang siya deficiency na mga ganon. Hindi masabihin na deficiency na kininako mo yung pera. Deficiencies in really in producing the necessary documents to complete the story. I don't know, but it would also run counter to public policy if you do not publish it. Just to inform the people of what is going on. But to the issue of whether the money has been stolen, that is pure.
Duterte also defended Francisco Duque III once again amid fresh calls for him to resign as health secretary.
Alam ko gusto mo nang mag-resign, pero alam mo rin na tatanggihan kita. Ngayon, noon you have attempted to resign twice. Wala ka namang ginawang masama. Bakit ka mag-resign? Do you think papayag ako na may isa dito sa cabinet member magnakaw basket 1,000? You really think that I would allow it?
COA earlier clarified its report did not indicate that the DOH had lost the funds to corruption. The health department says it's already settling the deficiencies. Lawmakers slamming President Duterte for his criticism of state auditors. Senator Pantelo Lacson says the chief executive was out of line as the Commission on Audit was simply doing its mandate. Lacson encourages the COA not to be intimidated by the president's remarks. Opposition Senator Francis Pangilinan also questioning Duterte's statements against COA. Pangilinan says the president should put more focus on the health department, which may have committed lapses in handling the COVID-19 response funds. House lawmaker Edsel Lagman echoes those sentiments. The Albay representative also believes Duterte should hold those who may have committed lapses liable. Heads must roll over the still unreleased benefits for COVID-19 medical frontliners. That's according to Senator Miguel Zubiri. He says, while the health department may be given more time to supply documentation of its pandemic spending, the billions in unutilized funds are another story.
That's the sad irony of it all. You promise them something and then you just give an excuse that the law has lapsed.
Mm-mm.
For me, that's BS. But somebody has to be an implementer for that. Hindi pwedeng hugas kamay na lang. Pag release mo doon sa regional office, hugas na ng kamay, tapos bahala na kayo dyan. But it's, at the end of the day, it's command responsibility.
Zubiri also hits the National Task Force Against COVID-19 for delaying the signing of tripartite agreements, preventing local government units and the private sector from purchasing their own vaccines.
From 500,000 a day, if they release these tripartite agreements, kaya nilang 1 million a day ang ating vaccination program, and the local governments and private sector will help. For example, Marinduque, Romblon, Sikihor, Camiguin. It's coming in trickles. But we have the funds to purchase this vaccine. Okay. Nandito na po yung pondo. Ito po ay locally sourced funding. Hindi po sa national government. Hindi na po natin kailangan mag-utang. Hindi na po tayo kailangan mag-realign ng budget.
State auditors also flagged the Labor Department for insufficient internal control measures in managing its COVID-19 funds. LACOA says some 22 million pesos intended for workers affected by the pandemic are still unclaimed. It adds over 1 million pesos were given as excessive or multiple payments to 213 beneficiaries, while around 3.76 billion pesos in COVID-19 funds remain unutilized. But the Labor Department refutes the audit report.
Ang utilization namin ng funds is 99%. I don't know where that came from na merong funds na ganong kalaki na hindi namin nagamit. COA gave us the most unqualified rating position. That is the highest rating that COA can give to any agency. Kaya nagtaga ako, bakit lumabas yan?
Further investigation has been done by the department asking the regional offices to explain.
Disappointing. That's how the head of the Filipino Nurses United described President Duterte's latest defense of Health Secretary Francisco Duque III. The health department has claimed it has released nearly 11 billion pesos for more than 700,000 health workers in the country. That's on top of the 4 billion pesos in hazard pay for frontliners. But FNU President Maristela Abenojar says there are still a lot of health workers in both public and private hospitals who have yet to receive anything.
Paulit-ulit na lang ito na nangyayari, pero parang hindi na sila nagre-respond positively dun sa aming request. If you deprive one health worker, let's say one nurse, of their basic benefits, ang ibig sabihin yan ay marami siyang mga hindi mapapakain o mabibigyan ng maayos na pangangailangan just because hindi na ibigay yung due para sa kanya. And sinusugal na nila yung kanilang buhay. I mean, nakaka-disappoint.
I don't know. Basta ang Pilipinos, mabuti.
In his latest public address, President Duterte directed the health department to prioritize the release of funds for health workers.
Itong frontliners, unahin mo na lang. If there is enough money, bayaran mo. Mamatay, nakita mo yung mga frontliners. Tapos wala kang ibigay na suporta.
A House panel begins its probe into state medical insurer PhilHealth over COVID-19 related benefit packages. Our correspondent RG Cruz now joins us for an update. RG, go ahead.
Hi, Carmina. The House Committee on Health today began its investigation on House Committee on House Resolution 1966 filed by House Committee Chairman, Quezon 4th District Representative Angelina Helen Tan. In this particular resolution, the committee is being tasked to look into the confusion the availment of COVID-19 benefit packages under the PhilHealth because of the issuance of two circulars. One that treats suspect and probable cases as intermediate cases instead of confirmed cases in terms of benefits. Now, the Philippine Health Insurance Corporation accepted responsibility for the seven-month delay in the issuance of the circular that revised the amendment or revised the availment of the COVID-19-related package. Congresswoman Tan, in the hearing, pointed out that the delay in the issuance of the circulars caused some confusion, especially since the effectivity of the circular was made retroactive. We are still in the middle of the hearing, but we expect that this hearing will be abbreviated shortly to give way to a hearing of the House Committee on Public Accounts this afternoon, specifically on the hottest issue of the day, which is, of course, the red flags raised by the Commission on Audit on the availment of some 67 on the use of some 67 billion pesos of COVID-19 funds under the Department of Health. Erminia?
Right. Thanks a lot. Our correspondent RJ Cruz there joining us on the line. Take care, RJ. Keep safe. Moving on, the Delta variant poised to become the dominant COVID-19 strain in the Philippines. The Philippine Genome Center says the highly contagious variant is rapidly overtaking all the other coronavirus mutations based on the samples being submitted for study.
Nationally, based on submitted samples to us, mga 42% na po ng ating mga total sequences ang Delta. And this is even more noticeable po in the National Capital Region, where from about 10.56% of cases in June, nakikita po natin na ang mga Delta po ay nagtitake over na sa ating Alpha and Beta cases.
As of August 15th, the health department has confirmed 807 cases of the highly transmissible variant, which has been detected in all but one region in the country. The Philippines also recorded its first case of the Lambda COVID-19 variant over the weekend. But a researcher says the Delta variant is still the biggest threat.
There is data that shows that when you put the Lambda and the Delta together, the Delta beats the Lambda. If we work to contain the Delta, we effectively will contain the Lambda as well.
The COVID-19 reproduction number in the Philippines climbs to 1.55. Dr. Guido David from the Octor Research Group says the figure recorded last Sunday is an increase from the previous reproduction rate of 1.46. As for the National Capital Region, it currently has a reproduction rate of 1.85.
Nasa 72% na yung ICU utilization sa Metro Manila at hindi to agad-agad bababa kasi dahil tumataas pa yung bilang ng kaso. Ibig sabihin, mananatili siyang above 70%. Yung hospital bed occupancy natin sa Metro Manila, tumataas rin. Nasa 64% na. Maari na siyang umabot ng 70% based on sa projection namin by next week. Ibig sabihin yan, yun nga, baka magiging factor ito kung ano yung magiging decision ng IATF whether to extend yung quarantine or kung ibababa na sa something like MECQ.
The Philippines logged 14,610 new COVID-19 infections Monday. That's the third highest daily tally since the start of the pandemic. It was also the third straight day fresh cases reached more than 14,000. The number of active infections now passed 106,000. 27 more patients also died, while over 10,000 recovered. The situation in hospitals in Metro Manila getting worse amid the rise in COVID-19 cases. At the Muntinlupa Hospital, patients now outnumber the beds. Santa Ana Hospital in Manila, meanwhile, had to put up additional tents at the parking lot. As for the Philippine General Hospital, non-COVID patients are now being redirected to other facilities. Occupancy at the Asian Hospital in Muntinlupa, that's full as well. The hospital's medical chief says almost all of its COVID facilities in the past month were unvaccinated.
for the past 1.5 months, we've had 7 deaths. And all of them, I would say, are unvaccinated. Yung isa na nabakunahan nga, kaya lang ang unfortunately, less than 2 weeks after the second dose, nagkaroon siya ng COVID. So you would presume that the protection is not as much. He was 81 years old, a male, and had lots of comorbidity. But the others of the 7, talagang hindi pa ho sila nababakunahan talaga. Ang laki po ng impact ng vaccination sa mortality ng COVID.
Doctor there explaining that most of the fatalities that they had there in the hospital were unvaccinated patients. Moving on, President Duterte asked for the U.S. government's help in procuring more COVID-19 vaccines. Earlier this month, the Philippines received 3 million doses of the Moderna jab from America. The U.S. is the biggest contributor to the vaccine-sharing COVAX facility.
I am just asking America to give us more. Kung meron lang sila, we are not, we know that mauna kami, or kami muna, we first before you. We understand it and we accept it. But if there is an excess of supply sa inyo, pakitulong naman dito sa bayan ko. We have the money, we buy, we do not ask. We have saved money for this event.
In business, cash remittances from overseas Filipino workers once again grew in June. But as Warren de Guzman tells us, OFWs are calling out the Philippine government for repeatedly denying their families lockdown aid.
Overseas Filipinos sent home $2.64 billion in June to take care of their families amid the COVID-19 pandemic. The June total for OF remittances coursed through banks was 7% higher year on year. That was slower compared to the remittance growth in April and May, but those months were helped by a low base after remittances contracted by 16% in April and 19% in May last year. June was actually the best month in terms of total cash remittances so far this 2021. The Philippine Central Bank has attributed the resilience of remittances from Filipino migrant workers to their altruism or heroism in the face of a global pandemic. But overseas Filipinos say it is getting harder and harder to send cash home. Many seafarers along Calao Street in Manila have lost all their income because the documents they need for deployment were delayed by the current lockdown.
Mga documents namin sa Marina, yun ang mga kailangan ng mga agency namin para kami makalis. So natitingga, di pa kami makasama sa government assistance. In times of trouble like dito, pandemic, wala kaming naasahan. Unfair ba? Tao naman kami. Parehas lang din sa kanila. Parehas lang tayo wala. Hindi kami nabibigyan.
Ako, OFW, hindi ako nasama sa ayuda. Pero actually, qualified naman din sana ako kasi bilang isang OFW na abutan ng lockdown, dapat may ayuda rin kami.
Overseas Filipino labor groups are also sad and angry at the horror stories of their families in the Philippines who have been denied aid because of the misconception that all OFW families are well-to-do. One OF worker, a labor group organizer based out of Hong Kong, says she's lost loved ones over the last week and has now been saddled with huge hospital debts. She says some of her fellow OF workers have resorted to extreme measures just to send money home, including taking on jobs that could get them deported.
Milyon ho yan yung nagastos. Ngayon, saan ho namin kukunin yun? Saan namin kukunin ang pambayad? No? Kung dito nga ho sa Hong Kong, nagkapatong-patong na ang utang ng mga kasama ko dito. Dahil lang para may padala dahil sa mga nakatamaan ng COVID ngayon. Dahil ang hirap-hirap po na umasa sa gobyerno na gamutin ang aming pamilya dyan.
The labor groups are calling on the government to focus time and funds on the pandemic instead of the proposed new Department for Overseas Filipinos, certified as urgent by President Rodrigo Duterte with an estimated price tag of 1.1 billion pesos.
Meron tayong kinikreate dito na DOFIL. Nang dami-daming dapat na pagtuunan ng ating gobyerno. Kagaya ng hospitalization or what. Kasi sa health nga yan sa atin, pero umaasa pa rin sila sa amin. Bakit ho ganun? Magkano lang ho ba kinikita namin?
Senator Joel Villanueva, chairman of the Senate Committee on Labor, has been pushing for the new department and is expected to sponsor it once deliberations are done. His office has responded to requests for comment, but has yet to issue a statement. Overseas Workers Welfare Association Administrator Hans Kakdak says all OFWs are included in their aid programs and they are willing to help those migrant workers who say they have not received any aid. Based on the OWA website, the agency has helped over 667,000 OFWs affected by the pandemic to return to the Philippines, and nearly all of those who were repatriated were also assisted in their return to their home regions. Kakdak adds, there are multiple OWA programs offering various benefits to overseas Filipinos and their families, including a calamity benefit worth 3,000 pesos per family, a medical benefit for up to 100,000 pesos, a COVID patient cash benefit of 10,000 pesos, and livelihood cash loans or grants, as well as scholarships for the children of affected overseas Filipino workers. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
A warning to social media influencers: pay your taxes or face criminal charges. That's according to the Philippine Bureau of Internal Revenue. The BIR says it has received reports that certain online personalities have not been paying their income taxes despite earning huge income from various social media platforms. It also says some don't register with the BIR to avoid having to declare their earnings. According to the Bureau, influencers may be liable for business tax as well. Online content creators who fail to comply may be charged with tax evasion, which imposes a fine of up to 10 million pesos and jail time of not less than 6 years. We're going to take a break now. Coming up, we'll turn our attention to the dire situation in Afghanistan following the Taliban takeover. Dateline Philippines will be right back. Stay with us here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
With Dateline Philippines here on ANC, here's another look at our headlines this noon. Lawmakers defend state auditors who got a tongue-lashing from President Duterte for exposing deficiencies in government's use of pandemic response funds. Meanwhile, a nurses group disappointed with the chief executive's refusal to punish Health Secretary Francisco Duque III for his failures. United Nations calls on the international community to ensure terrorism won't rise again in Afghanistan. And the death toll in Haiti's powerful quake now at 1,400, with thousands more injured. Back with more news, here's the latest now on the horrific situation unfolding in war-torn Afghanistan. Evacuation flights out of the country resume after crowds of people were cleared off the runway of Hamid Karzai International Airport in Kabul. Thousands ran to the airport as the Taliban militants seized control of the capital, prompting the U.S. to pause evacuations. At least seven people died during the chaos, with U.S. media saying some of them fell after clinging on to a military plane as it took off. Meanwhile, hundreds of soldiers of Afghanistan's former government have fled to Uzbekistan. Uzbekistan says the soldiers used dozens of military planes and helicopters to escape. One of the aircraft collided with an escorting Uzbek fighter jet, causing both to crash. U.S. President Joe Biden is standing by his decision to withdraw American troops from Afghanistan. Biden insists he's merely following through on the 2020 deal between the Taliban and his predecessor, Donald Trump. He also blames the current crisis on the Afghan army.
I stand squarely behind my decision. After 20 years, I've learned the hard way that there was never a good time to withdraw U.S. forces. That's why we're still there. We were clear-eyed about the risks. We planned for every contingency, but I always promised the American people that I would be straight with you. The truth is, this did unfold more quickly than we had anticipated. So what's happened? Afghanistan political leaders gave up and fled the country. The Afghan military collapsed, sometime without trying to fight. If anything, the developments of the past week reinforced that ending U.S. military involvement in Afghanistan now was the right decision. American troops cannot and should not be fighting in a war and dying in a war that Afghan forces are not willing to fight for themselves.
Meanwhile, the Pentagon maintains while the U.S. was prepared for the Taliban's swift takeover of Afghanistan, it did not expect the Afghan army to give up so quickly and so easily.
There was certainly, as you do exercises, I don't want to go into too much detail here on these, it would certainly be wrong to conclude that the United States military did not view as a distinct possibility that the Taliban could overrun the country and including Kabul.
Some analysts, meanwhile, are calling on America's move to withdraw from Afghanistan a betrayal. They say the American government essentially abandoned the nation.
Well, there is a sense of abandonment. There is a sense of betrayal. There is a sense that they worked with us side by side, implemented many of our programs, had the same aspirations we had for them, and now they don't know what's going to happen to them.
That the manner in which the United States comprehensively abandoned the Afghan government, which was its ally, will make many other reluctant American allies think twice about depending on American commitments.
The United Nations is calling on the international community to prevent Afghanistan from again becoming a hotbed for terrorism. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres calling on the members of the Security Council to give the Afghan people humanitarian support and help secure their basic human rights. Earlier, the council called for urgent talks to create a new government in Afghanistan. They urged all parties to put an end to the crisis and to reach a peaceful settlement through an Afghan-led process of national reconciliation. But Afghanistan's envoy to the United Nations is worried the Taliban may not keep any of the promises they make.
We are extremely concerned about Taliban's not honoring their promises and commitments made in their statements at Doha and at other international fora. We've witnessed time and again how Taliban have broken their promises and commitments in the past.
Joining us now is Professor Romel Banlawi. He's the chairman of the Philippine Institute for Peace, Violence, and Terrorism Research. He's going to tell us all about his take on the Taliban's return to power in Afghanistan and why it should matter for the rest of the world, including the Philippines. Professor Banlawi, nice to see you again. Thanks for joining us today.
Yes, good afternoon, Carmina, and I'm so pleased to be back in your program.
All right, harrowing images coming from Afghanistan, but even more harrowing, though, is the images, or are the images, that we won't be able to see as the Taliban reestablishes its hold on Kabul. But tell us, let me ask you this, Professor Banlawi, was this inevitable? What we're seeing right now, was it inevitable?
Well, as early as February 2020, there were already a lot of signs about Taliban's willing to take over Afghanistan. And that is the reason why the United States withdrew from Afghanistan, because of the agreement that the U.S. entered into with the Taliban officials, and that is that they will not allow Afghanistan to be the breeding ground again of international terrorism, and that the Taliban forces will contribute to the peace building of Afghanistan and economic reconstruction of Afghanistan in order for the Afghan people to enjoy their normal life again. So that was the agreement. So, and even a month before that, you know, China already met some officials of the Taliban, indicating that the Taliban was already pursuing what I call international diplomacy in order to get international legitimacy. And Taliban officials also talked with some officials of Russia and even neighboring countries in Pakistan. So those are signs that the Taliban are in fact going to take over the government in Afghanistan.
So was the president, or was America naive in this case?
Well, I think the United States miscalculated the situation and committed what I call an error in judgment of the situation, because the United States was responding to domestic pressures about withdrawing from Afghanistan, because it's already costing the United States a lot of money. You know, we're talking about trillion of US dollars and killings of around 180,000 American soldiers. So those things are already unacceptable to the American people, considering that they are also suffering from the challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic. And at the same time, also overstretched resources of the United States in fighting a war that is not their own war. It's an internal armed conflict. So Biden has adopted a change in its policy, and it's time for the United States to withdraw from countries with internal conflicts and let the country resolve their own internal conflicts, with the caveat that the United States will still continue to support democratic forces in those conflict areas, including Afghanistan.
It's interesting that you brought up China. We're going to talk about that in a while. But first, I want to ask you, I mean, you've heard the commentaries out there. Words are being used like abandonment, betrayal. But really, how much of what is happening right now in Kabul is because of the Biden administration? And how much of it really is because of the Afghan political leaders, Professor?
I think I share the sympathy of some observers about the feeling of abandonment of Afghanistan, because the United States has the political, moral, and even strategic responsibility to sustain the political development and even economic reconstruction of Afghanistan. You know, if you just feel difficulty in helping a country, don't just abandon it, find ways how to contribute further to the strengthening of the political institutions, and at the same time strengthening the economic development of a country long beset by armed conflicts. And the United States is part of this conflict, so the United States should also provide the solution in this kind of conflict. And withdrawing immediately, I think it's not what I call a prudent decision on the part of the United States. So for me, this is a strategic, political, and tremendous moral blunders of the United States.
Two things, though, with what you just said, Professor Banlawi. One is that Afghanistan is not America. And the second is they've had 20 years. The Afghan political leaders had 20 years. We're not just talking about America here, Professor.
Yes, but America was responsible for erecting a regime in Afghanistan that it supported for 20 years. So it has also the responsibility to sustain this kind of support and also sustain the strengthening of the political institutions and democratic lives in Afghanistan. Now that the Taliban is there, more threats are in fact forthcoming to the United States. But of course, in fairness with the United States, not only the responsibility of the United States, it's a global responsibility. So for me, the immediate action that the international community should do is the protection and safety of civilians torn in conflict situations, especially if civil war takes place in Afghanistan. And I'm sure that the civil war is really looming in Afghanistan, because there are still anti-Taliban forces, like, for example, groups associated with the Northern Alliance are still regrouping their forces in order to mount their resistance against the Taliban authorities, and also existing warlords in Afghanistan that are considered to be Taliban, not to mention former Taliban who have defected to the Islamic States. And of course, if you put to the equation the role of India, and India will also be part of this whole situation. So it's a responsibility of the international community to make sure that civilians are protected, including the overseas Filipino contract workers who refuse to leave Afghanistan.
Later on, we're going to talk more about the humanitarian disaster, as some observers have been calling it, that's just waiting to happen there in Kabul. But I do want to ask you, what does this mean for the rest of the world? You have United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres already sounding the alarm that this may just lead to once again Afghanistan being a safe haven for terrorism. How likely is that to happen, given what you've seen the past days, Professor?
Well, we have to wait for succeeding actions of the Taliban's ruling its country. But now we are banking on the statement of the Taliban officials that they will pursue peaceful international relations. And therefore, we need to know what kinds of actions that the Taliban authorities will take in order to pursue peaceful international relations. And at the same time, the Taliban officials also released a strong statement stating that they will exert best efforts to maintain peace and order in Afghanistan so that the Afghan people will resume their normal life again. So those are the positive signs that we want to see, indicating that the Afghan authorities want Afghanistan to perform like a normal state, like Saudi Arabia or Iran, a state that is adhering to the Islamic principle, but at the same time conforming to international rules and regulations.
Professor, isn't that a little bit naive of you, considering that you're talking about a group here that has repressive ways, especially when it comes to women and girl children, Professor?
Well, that's the dilemma of the Taliban government, because while it intends to pursue peaceful international relations, but there are also international requirements for sovereign states to follow. And one of the international requirements is for sovereign states to conform to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in protecting human rights of all its citizens, particularly the protection of women and children. And we know that the Taliban have this reputation of curtailing the rights of women. So we want to see how the Taliban will address that kind of situation, pursuing peaceful international relations, but at the same time pursuing its Islamic governance of Afghanistan. So, but if Afghanistan failed to deliver its promises to the international community, I think the international community has the obligation to take actions.
But the international community also had 20 years.
Well, that's the 20 years, of course, will be long. So it's really difficult to address a complex situation like Afghanistan, because there are also internal political dynamics. You know, Afghanistan is a divided country. There are a lot of political forces there. And at the same time, also, aside from internal political dynamics, there are also geopolitical considerations. You know, the situation of Afghanistan will be the arena of India-Pakistan conflict. It will also be arena of US-China rivalry. So it's very complicated, and time is really needed to address the situation in Afghanistan. And for me, building Afghanistan will take more than 20 years. It will take a generation, you know. And look at our country, the Philippines. You know, we have been experiencing our political independence from America since 1946, but we're still undergoing the painful process of state building and nation building. We still have these internal problems in Mindanao. We still have the local communist insurgency. Well, that's it's the fate of many developing nations. They have to undergo this painful political process of nation building and state building, and Afghanistan is not exception to that kind of rule.
When UN United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres sounded the alarm against the rise of terrorism once again in Afghanistan, did that concern you at all, given that, you know, every time we would talk about terrorism, each and every conversation we've had, Professor Banlawi, really pointed to one thing, that when you have conflict, armed conflict, civilian conflict, civil war, that most likely terrorism is not far behind. With what is happening right now, do you think that terrorism and Afghanistan once again being a breeding ground of terrorism is likely to happen? And how concerned are you that that will find its way to our country?
We need to understand, Carmina, the terrorism in Afghanistan is not, it's not only coming from the Taliban. Now, if the Taliban government wants a stop to the idea of Afghanistan being the breeding ground of terrorism, it will be difficult for the Taliban government to do that, because, you know, propagation of terrorism is not only being done by the Taliban. We still have the Islamic State in Afghanistan. You know, the Islamic State Khorasan is based in Afghanistan. We also have this Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. So if Al-Qaeda and Islamic State will continue to do its operations, then Afghanistan, if not stabilized, and it will be the breeding ground of international terrorism. And we cannot solely blame the Taliban for that, because Taliban is just one of the many actors. You know, we still have the Islamic State, we still have the Al-Qaeda and other breakaway groups and other armed groups that are engaged in many acts of terrorism. So even though the Taliban government will demonstrate its sincerity to govern Afghanistan in a usual way, without peace and stability there, if the Taliban government fails to restore peace and stability and it fails to prevent civil war in Afghanistan, then the Islamic State and even the Al-Qaeda will take advantage of this opportunity to make Afghanistan the breeding ground of international terrorism.
And that it'll eventually, and the possibility of that morphing into something even greater and even more dangerous, and that it would eventually find its way here to the country. How likely is that, Professor?
Yes, because you know already that the groups and personalities responsible in the 2017 Marawi siege was led by Isnilon Hapilon. And with the death of Isnilon Hapilon, he has been replaced by another person, an Indonesia, by the name of Saifullah. And Saifullah is now based in Afghanistan, being cuddled by Taliban forces who defected to the Islamic State. So that will square in the overall equation. So we need to be vigilant in the developments happening in Afghanistan, because there's still link. And another thing, the victory of the Taliban can also inspire other Islamic groups worldwide to pursue their brand of jihad, that it can happen, that they can also do it. So the Taliban action in Afghanistan can inspire others. So we should remain vigilant and prevent the situation in Afghanistan to spill over to the southern Philippines. So this will be a tremendous challenge to our security officials to prevent the spillover of conflict in Afghanistan to reach the Philippine shore.
Professor, a while ago you were talking about China, and news reports have it already that China does want to help here. When you talk about the human rights problem, we already heard that China has said that she is willing to work with the U.S. to sort of find a soft landing here for Afghanistan to prevent a humanitarian disaster from unfolding. What kind of scenarios are you looking at here? And is China really going to be beneficial in preventing a humanitarian disaster there in Afghanistan?
Well, China has a big role to play in peace building in Afghanistan.
Why do you say so?
It can convince the Taliban officials to really behave like a normal state, because China has an interest to put Afghanistan in its Belt and Road Initiative in Central Asia and South Asia.
Yeah, but Professor, it's interesting that you said that. How can we expect that from China when China itself herself is not even adhering and following international laws?
Well, that's a matter of debate. But for China has already discussed this with the Taliban officials during their meeting last month, that China is willing to play a constructive role in peace building in Afghanistan. And if the Taliban takes over, China is also willing to pursue economic relations with the new government, with the intention to really rebuild Afghanistan in its process of political transition. So how? China is willing to invest. China is willing to provide aid to the government in Afghanistan and willing to pursue normal international relations. And that's the context of the Taliban's declaration that they want to pursue peaceful international relations. But we have to understand also that China does not really fully trust the Taliban because, you know, the Taliban were also responsible for supporting separatists. Groups in China, particularly in Xinjiang province, involving the militant Uyghurs. So the trust is, the mistrust is already there, but China wants to give Afghanistan a chance because a violent Afghanistan is also anathema to the overall plan of China to promote Belt and Road Initiative in the area. So
here's the thing, though, Professor, you talk about trust and mistrust. And it seems like, as you said, China is really interested in how the Taliban can gain legitimacy. But when you talk about trust and mistrust and legitimacy, China is also having that same kind of a problem. How do you think China, or can China actually be trusted by the world as it deals with the Taliban and as it promises to help the Taliban in its quest for legitimacy in the world stage, Professor?
Well, the trust can be addressed by pragmatic cooperation. That's the formula of China. Although right now we don't trust each other, but we have this, you know, natural inclination for self-preservation. So we need to pursue pragmatic cooperation. And if that pragmatic cooperation works, then trust can be built. So that's the formula of China. And we just hope that that kind of formula will work. You know, but because if it does not work, that will fuel more conflicts and that will create more anxieties, not only in the region, but also in the entire world.
We're going to have to leave it at that. Professor Romel Banlawia, international studies expert there. He's the chairman of the Institute for Peace, Violence and Terrorism Research. Appreciate you coming to the show. Thanks for joining us today. Take care. Keep safe.
Thank you very much, Carmina. Take care also. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Appreciate it. Moving on, Haiti scrambles to get humanitarian aid and supplies to regions badly hit by a magnitude 7.2 earthquake. The tremor killed more than 1,400 people while leaving nearly 7,000 wounded. The city of Lekki suffered the most damage, but gangs are in control of key access points to the city, complicating relief efforts. The United Nations calling for a humanitarian corridor to let aid pass through gang-held territories. Meanwhile, floods are hampering rescue efforts. Teams are already racing against time to dig out survivors ahead of a tropical storm that's expected to bring up to 15 inches of rain. Haiti is still clawing its way back to recovery after the devastation of a strong tremor some 11 years ago. It was also plunged into political turmoil following the assassination of its president just last month. In sports, the Tokyo Paralympics will take place with little to no spectators. That's as the Japanese government prepares to extend its lockdown in its capital and other regions until September 12. The Paralympic competitions will run from August 24 to September 5. Six Filipino athletes will be participating in the Paralympics, where they will compete in weightlifting, taekwondo, athletics, and swimming. In the NBA, defensive specialist Marcus Smart staying with the Boston Celtics. Smart agreed to re-sign with Boston for 4 more years at a price tag of $77 million. The combo guard is a perennial fixture in the NBA's all-defensive teams. He also averaged career highs in scoring and assists last season. That'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Playback this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC. We'll be right back.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.